Videodrome is a 1983 sci-fi horror film written and directed by David Cronenberg. Max is the president of Civic TV, a Canadian television station that specializes in softcore pornography and gratuitous violence, at least as much as he can get away with. Max wants to push the envelope of taste into something more hardcore for his audience. His assistant, Harlan, discovers a television broadcast called Videodrome, a show in which people are tortured so graphically that it almost seems real. Max considers pirating the show and using it on Civic TV without licensing it. Max defends the controversial nature of his television station to a talk show host, and while being interviewed, he meets Nikki and forms a relationship with her. Intrigued by Videodrome, Nikki leaves town to audition and is not heard from again. Max's associate, Masha, informs him that Videodrome is part of a political movement and warns him to stay away from it. Max begins to hallucinate. These visions are tied to watching the show. He tries to track down Brian Oblivion, a philosopher who believes television will change the course of human history and how people engage with the world. Oblivion actually passed away months ago. He wanted to use Videodrome to bring about his vision of the future, but his partners had more sinister plans in mind. These people include Max's assistant, who was working for Videodrome the whole time. The show's secret producer, Spectacular Optical Corporation, wants to use the show to give brain tumors to anyone so interested in the extreme sex and violence of Videodrome. Spectacular Optical and its cohorts are concerned that the rest of the world is getting tougher while Canada and America are getting softer. Max is brainwashed by two competing powers, for and against Videodrome, and after killing people on both sides, he commits suicide in hopes of ascending to a new level of consciousness.
After all, there is nothing real outside our perception of reality, is there?
Brian Oblivion says that watching Videodrome does not create a simple tumor. It creates a new organ, a new way to perceive reality. Max knows this to be true. After watching Videodrome, he begins to hallucinate. He sees televisions come to life. He sees one person when it is actually another, and so forth. Oblivion says there is nothing real outside our perception of reality. What Oblivion is talking about is actually a subset of metaphysics in philosophy called idealism, not to be confused with moral idealism, which is a subset of ethics in philosophy. No, idealism is the belief that only minds and the contents of the minds exist. This rejects the concept of dualism, the mind and body being separate and distinct, something discussed in a previous episode. Idealism denies the possibility of knowing the non-mental or even the existence of the non-mental altogether. Some of this philosophy has roots in religion, particularly Indian Buddhism, but contemporary philosophers know idealism best from George Berkeley, or Berkeley, depending on your pronunciation and your proximity to California. Berkeley might have had a lot to say about Videodrome and Brian Oblivion had he lived to see the film. Berkeley, much like Oblivion, believed that nothing exists outside our perceptions. He once said, "It is evident to anyone who takes a survey of the objects of human knowledge that they are either ideas actually imprinted on the senses, or else such as are perceived by attending to the passions and operations of the mind, or lastly, ideas formed by help of memory and imagination, either compounding, dividing, or barely representing those originally perceived in the aforesaid ways." Now, that is a mouthful, but in more plain language, he believed that nothing exists unless we are looking at it or otherwise sensing it, tasting it, smelling it, etc. It can be summed up as esse est percepi, to be is to be perceived. This does not mean, according to Berkeley, that objects just disappear when no human beings are experiencing them. When Max leaves his apartment, Berkeley would say that the apartment would still exist without him. When Max is asleep at the beginning of the film, the television continues to exist while not perceived by him. Berkeley, an Irish bishop, would say that this is because everything is always perceived by God. If an object does not exist unless it is perceived, and objects continue to exist when humans do not see them, then someone else must be witnessing them at all times, and that person, according to Berkeley, is God. Spectacular Optical's motto is keeping an eye on the world. That is literally what Berkeley said was God's function. Modern philosophers pointed out that this was specious reasoning, and indeed some of Berkeley's contemporaries did as well. When watching Videodrome, an audience can be forgiven for being confused. What are Max's hallucinations, and what are not, they might ask. How can he retrieve a gun from his body, have it mesh with his body, and have it be functional enough to kill people, including himself? Max, due to his hallucinations, is an unreliable narrator. We follow Max, he is our protagonist, so maybe even more than the obvious hallucinations are manufactured by his mind. Some characters appear only on television screens, and others watch television only to become techno-zombies. Who is real? What is real? Well, remember Oblivion's words and think about Berkeley's idealism. Max is able to hallucinate so strongly that reality around his hallucinations has changed. This is almost like Berkeley's idealism in reverse. Max perceives a hole in his chest and other things, and because it is within human perception, it becomes real. This is actually a counter-argument to Berkeley's idealism, in the real world, not the movie, because human perception can be altered by drugs, mental illness, and so forth. If we can perceive a reality that does not exist, then our perception to reality ratio must not be 1-to-1. And if that is true, then reality must exist, in some respects, independent of our simple human perception. In other words, the universe continues even without us.
The battle for the mind of North America will be fought in the video arena. The Videodrome.
The metaphysics of the film are like an aura of abstract thought around more grounded ideas about how we consume media. Max watches Videodrome and begins to mistake fantasy for reality, eventually creating reality from fantasy. That is the horror of the film, but it represents something more tangible, more of our world. In the film, Brian Oblivion says that the television screen is the retina of the mind's eye. Television is part of the physical structure of the brain. Therefore, whatever happens on television emerges as raw experiences for those who watch it. Television is reality, he says, and reality is less than television. This is not just part of the fantasy of this sci-fi film, it means in the real world, observing television makes it real to us. At the time of the film, television was becoming more and more important due to the proliferation of cable TV in the years prior to the production of the film, but we can see even more now about how our media affects us with the advent of the internet. Humanity exists somewhere between the mind and technological influence. What the film calls the new flesh. That's why we see Max become one with technology on more than one occasion. Cronenberg has said, "Since I see technology as being an extension of the human body, it's inevitable that it should come home to roost." That, more than anything else, is the core of Videodrome. Our media informs us and changes how we perceive reality. It has changed how we communicate with one another. It teaches us half-truths about cultures that are not our own through stereotypes and mischaracterizations in film and television. Cronenberg's horror films sometimes feature an external force chasing down the protagonist, but often the horror is internal. It comes from within. In the case of Videodrome and media, the film argues that television can influence the viewer, but only if the viewer allows themselves to be influenced by some unconscious choice. It cannot force you to do something you would not otherwise do, but it can awaken something ugly already inside you, or reinforce a negative, unsavory, or dangerous aspect of society that pre-exists that media. Videodrome is surprisingly precise in its prediction about how reliant on our media we will become, not to mention its monopoly by shady forces and the coming of reality television. Cronenberg could not have envisioned, say, Netflix, but he did see a dependency on mass media, a shared dependence upon which we judge normalcy. We carry around our smartphones everywhere we go, I certainly do, and that brings us much closer to the cyborg that Max becomes. Videodrome opens with a station identification for a Civic TV, followed by a pre-recorded message about Max's appointments for the day. This reveals the extent to which technology has invaded its characters' personal spaces and interpersonal relationships. Civic TV's motto, "The one you take to bed with you," implies that video is becoming the new normalcy, the new relationship. Again, the question, who is real? What is real? Well, can't that also be asked of our world? For example, our perception of how guns operate is colored by how they function in action movies and television shows. Most people have seen far more guns used, sometimes inaccurately and in glorifying terms, in media more than guns fired in real life. Most of us only know what war feels like because we have seen war movies. Most of us only know what distant cultures, alien to our day-to-day, are like based on how they are depicted in film and television. Our media does influence our perception of reality, whether we choose to admit that or not. Masha tells Max that Videodrome is dangerous because it has a philosophy. It is politically motivated. Many people do not put a lot of thought into what they watch on television or in the movie theater, but those controlling media empires often have political motives. This results in propaganda delivered to people who do not realize that is what they are watching, and when confronted with the inherent politics or message of a piece of media, many prefer to dismiss this outright and decry any social critique of our media as censorship rather than become introspective about what we are consuming. George Barclay may not have been right about his theories, but we are, in a sense, creating worlds with our perceptions. Haven't we created artificial realities upon artificial realities? Aren't we building them on top of the ruins of others? At the end of the film, Max is prompted by a vision of Nikki to shoot himself and thus become free of his old flesh. Audiences interpret this a variety of ways, and considering Cronenberg envisioned at least three different endings, one could argue that the film does not completely build to this moment if it could so easily be interchanged with two or more alternates. But based on the text of the film, I would argue against Max actually transcending here. It looks like a powerful force inside the television has fed him another lie.
Hi everyone, if you like what I do, please click on the orange Patreon link below. That's how this show happens. It's also the only way to request an episode. Also, there are other benefits to pledging, so check it out. The information is on my Patreon page. I'll see you next week.